Another day, another video on gatekeeping. Because it is absolutely what our fandoms need right now. If we are going to have any chance of turning the tide against 5 years of infiltration, subversion, and straight up damage to our favorite settings, we are going to have to go in depth on this. And up until this point, we have been talking a little bit more about the fluffier topics. Why is gatekeeping bad? Why does it have a negative reputation, particularly considering that those who keep saying it's bad use gatekeeping at every turn, and to a far more vicious and comprehensive degree than anything we've even dreamed of doing. We've also talked about how to identify the outsider, the reason why they behave in the way they do, and we've touched a little bit upon how to use their own weapons against them in the case of the weaponized hypocrisy video. But a thing that I keep repeating again and again is the fact that nothing will ever happen unless you make the argument, unless you actually engage and call out the nonsense when you see it in the capacity that you have to do so. In my case, it's making videos like these, providing a guidebook to people to inform them as to the usual tactics of the outsider, how to identify them, how to combat them. But specifically now, what does making the argument look like? How do you begin to counter some of the more oft-regurgitated SJW talking points? That is what we're going to be discussing today. And so I have here two wonderful little web pages to provide excellent examples and illustrations. The first is titled Racism in the Nerd Geek Community. This is practically just a point-for-point breakdown of every single statement and argumentation point of the outsider. Usually, this comes down to simply just stating something unequivocally. The overrunning you kind of thing, where they simply say, "This is racist," and because you don't know enough about it immediately, and racism is bad, you thus react with, "It's racist? Oh god, I never even know. Well, we've got to stop that, because racism bad, right?" Without ever actually looking into whether or not it is racist. And 9 times out of 10, it isn't, because as we talked about with the feminist frequency earnings, these people have a vested interest in lying to you, whether it be financial interest or simply just influence within a hobby or a setting. The second example comes from Wired. "Why are there so few women in wargaming?" it asks. All innocent-like. "It's just asking a question, bruh. Why are there so few women in an ultra-violent, hyper-competitive science fiction hobby?" A genuine question. No subterfuge or guile here, mind you. This is the perfect example of the attack article. It begins by finding a group, a collective, which it can define. In this case, universally defined them as the victim. Oh, they don't have to be the victim of anything particularly important or dangerous or even bad in any real way. In fact, the problem that this article presents is that men are being nice to women. Like I said, it doesn't have to be much of a problem. The point is that you find a group, and then you make them the victim through your framing, and then you approach the community you wish to take power in and go, "Look at this, isn't it horrible? I have interviews with women who say, yes, men were being nice to me at a tournament." Well, we'll get into a little bit more full detail later, but to give you the lowdown here, a woman, young, perhaps even pretty, was at a historical wargaming tournament, not even Warhammer, because again, it doesn't even have to be a problem related to the hobby they're trying to infiltrate. All of that is irrelevant so long as you have a victim. And a 50-plus-year-old man playing the game was approached by her and went like,
Oh, are you somebody's daughter here? Have you come to watch your daddy play?
Because this is a tournament with 98% men in it, and so he simply makes the assumption she's probably somebody's relative. Because who else but crusty old men play historical war game tournaments? And this was the grand problem. And of course, you all know the solution. How do we fix this grand injustice? Socialism, of course. You just need to accept all of our talking points and do anything we ask you to, and then suddenly, your hobby will be filled with women. The sad part is, this argument worked 5 years ago. Hell, it probably still works today on a lot of people, because, again, the simple fact is, I, and you probably as well, when we first started getting into this, the hobbies, gaming, etc., as young people, this was not socially acceptable. God, no, and it certainly wasn't popular. So the idea of girls having an interest in a hobby? Like goddamn catnip. Anywho, let's begin with the talking points, the racism in the nerd geek community, shall we? Because it provides you with an example of the usual blanket statements, and I'll go through them and give you an idea of how you might respond to them. It starts out, traditionally and unavoidably enough, by saying that, oh, everyone's talking about this, this is a topic that we have to have now. Quote, with the discussion around racism happening all around us, we need to seriously talk about racism in the nerd community. Do we? Is this the same talk that we have had to have now for the last half a decade? And yet, by your own admission, you seem to have achieved absolutely nothing? Could this then be a problem entirely located in your own imagination, perhaps? It goes on then again to simply just state that there is a problem. Quote, we have a lot of issues with prejudice and racism. Do you? Well, actually, no, you know what? I can believe that the left, in fact, has a lot of problems with prejudice and racism. As we, for example, saw recently here, a NYC psychoanalyst diagnoses whiteness as a malignant, parasitic-like condition. Oh, I can absolutely believe that you on the left have a problem with racism, all right. And that should be the first step right there. There are so many cases of leftist straight out open racism available on the internet right now that any accusations of racism within our hobby communities, pot, meet the goddamn kettle. And I, for one, see absolutely no reason why you should accept a lecture on racism from a racist. The next step then is usually drudging up another series of statements to try and illustrate the point. Quote, black cosplayers are frequently othered, ostracized, or outright harassed. Racial slurs are commonplace among gaming forums, voice chats, and Discord. It's so common, there's a F, because YouTube, joke about it. The biggest YouTuber on the planet has frequently courted with racist rhetoric. Words. So, black cosplayers are frequently othered, ostracized, or outright harassed. Are they? Where is this happening? How is this happening? What's the reason? What is the form of ostracization? Because usually this will be something idiotic, like, oh, I haven't seen that character played by a black man before, or something like that. Innocuous throwaway nonsense. Racial slurs are common on the internet. Yes, welcome aboard. This is the internet, where people will quite literally say anything they can possibly think of to say specifically to get a rise out of you. If you can't handle it, you shouldn't be here. And yes, indeed, there are jokes about racism, because racism is ridiculous. And then, of course, the self-defeating point. You cannot have a lefty argument without it. The biggest YouTuber on the planet has frequently courted with racist rhetoric. What he means is, PewDiePie said the N-word. once, then apologized profusely, and was hammered for it by a near-unified internet, and he lost several sponsors over it, which seems to indicate that rather than having a problem with racism, we seem to have a problem with one specific word, and a rather overblown response to someone saying it in a heated moment. You might also here choose to stress the fact that we are talking about yet another Voldemort word. The very idea of he whose name cannot be spoken used to be an over-the-top example of an oppressive, censorious society, or something so horrible that the mere mention of it would cause the universe to rend itself asunder or other such nonsense. And yet now we have attributed this power to a word that, and I will make this argument as many times as it takes, and you should too, a word that the black community has actually, genuinely reclaimed. They have managed to take a word that was meant to belittle them, that was meant to insult them, a purely malicious word, and they have turned it into a word that means friend and brother. That is a genuinely incredible achievement, and yet we treat them like children by going, oh no, you didn't actually do that, you can't actually handle that word. We're gonna just ignore all of your achievements in taking that negative word and transforming it. Why? Because we're the leftists, and we really don't think you're worth all that much. We then move on to the anti-gatekeeping argument. Any conversation about the quote very few fictional black characters in the media we consume becomes a shit show of bigotry or accusations pandering to SJWs. Black and POC actors and creatives suffer gauntlets of abuse, especially if they are cast in significant roles or given major positions. Think about how long it took the MCU to have a movie with a black lead, or how there's only one black Disney princess. Think about how John Boyega was treated when cast in Star Wars. Think about how Donald Glover got abused for the mere thought of him playing Peter Parker. These are always the easiest ones to refute, because they don't understand what they're talking about. These are the moments where you can really hammer them and demonstrate the fact that these are not fans. These are outsiders trying to force their way into hobbies purely for their own benefits. And that is, of course, precisely why we make it into a shit show of bigotry, quote unquote, or accusation of pandering to SJWs, because it is pandering. Think about how long it took the MCU to have a movie with a black lead. Right there, that's the headshot. Because the first Marvel cinematic hero was goddamn Blade, played by Wesley Snipes. And may I add as well, played incredibly well to the point where he has literally defined the character of Blade. As for Disney princesses, I don't know if we're going by a one-drop rule here or if we have a chart of acceptable skin color to reach the holy grail of POC, but according to Disney Princesses Wiki, we have Jasmine, Pocahontas, Mulan, Tiana, Moana, Raya, and Esmeralda, all as the current official Disney princesses, which is, incidentally, around about a 50-50 split with the light-skinned ones. And it took me about 30 seconds to look that up online. Always look up their claims, because 9 times out of 10, it's going to be bullshit. As for John Boyega, who was he mistreated by? The Chinese. And of course his own company for wanting to sell in China, minimizing his role on screen. You can also blame the creators of the Star Wars movies for giving him the tiniest, most pointless bit role character imaginable. Which certainly didn't help much either, since his actual character too was awful. A indoctrinated stormtrooper soldier, which sees one of his comrades killed in front of him, then starts murdering the rest of his comrades with not just cold-bloodedness, but outright joy. God damn, that is an awful character. And Donald Glover. Here again, we have an example of why we kick up a fuss and shitstorm when it comes to the pandering to the SJWs. Because Donald Glover should not play Peter Parker. Peter Parker is a defined character. He is a white guy. Donald Glover can, however, play Miles Morales, no problems. Why? Because he fits that character. In fact, I think he would work out excellently, actually. But this, again, comes back to the fact that they don't understand what they're arguing for. They don't get it. They don't understand that there is actually a Black Spider-Man and that he is a separate character to Peter Parker. And now, of course, with the worthless, self-defeating justifications out of the way, we get to the real rub of it. I personally believe that you need to find ways you can fix your own spaces to help dismantle the systems of injustice that have killed so many. Has the systems of injustice in hobbies killed that many? No, of course not, because we have completely left the realms of a hobby now. We don't care about that. That's not the goal. It's the systems that we need to dismantle. This has nothing to do with the hobbies, the universes, the settings. That is not the point, because we are only using that as a weapon. Ask them for specific instances within the hobby, and whenever they bring up this, systems of injustice, throw it in their face, reject it. Or in this case, even better, ask them the simple question. What has contributed more to a spirit of racism? A police officer who was immediately suspended, then arrested, put on trial, and found guilty, whilst being near universally condemned by a lockstep news media across the globe, or an organization that has caused $1 billion worth of damages whilst doing nothing but enriching itself. The tale of Black Lives Matter's co-founder, Patrice Cullors, who now has $3 million in property, is a well-known one these days. This is a grift, pure and simple. What is even worse is, according to Black Lives Matter's official finances, they received some $90 million. They only spent a quarter of it, and they didn't even spend that necessarily on the good work. They simply handed over that quarter to other Black Lives Matter's chapters. Where it went from there, nobody knows. It probably found its way into the pockets of the individual members, just like it did with Patrice Cullors. And as for the remaining $60 million that they didn't disperse to their other chapters, again, nobody knows. Where has the Black community been measurably improved by Black Lives Matter? Well, only in a handful of instances, namely the BLM founders themselves, who are sitting on the money. And this is a key point that needs to be brought up. This is not a question about fighting against actual, genuine racism. The anti-racist crowd are grifters, near universally, and the evidence for it is overwhelming and completely and utterly irrefutable. And whilst you're on it as well, when they say, quote, that means having hard conversation with friends, family, and in this case, our fellow nerd community, tell them, I'm having the hard conversation right now by telling you to shut up. Because all this is, again, is an attempt to politicize the idea, to politicize it wider. Oh, this isn't a conversation you need to have with just the community. No, no, no. We're not caring about the hobbies anymore. It's back to the systems of injustice now. The systems of injustice within 40K, within Marvel, within Star Wars that have killed so many. And you need to talk to your friends and family about this. No. No, you don't. And now that we've gone through those points, let's have a look at the attack article. Because these are usually the things that will also be linked or listed as a part of the argumentation. Oh, hey, look here. There was an article written about how terrible we all are. We should all do better. It begins with a picture of a Games Workshop shop, which gives you the impression that this is going to be about Games Workshop products, Warhammer and 40K, right? And it begins with framing the victim as always. In this case, a woman by the name of Becky Enstenides, who runs her own little hobby shop selling historical miniatures. She tells the heart-wrenching story of going to a historical wargaming event, not Warhammer, not 40k, historical wargaming, a niche within a niche. And at this tournament, the horror, the terror, the worst thing imaginable happened to her again and again and again. The other participants, which are apparently all white men, 50 or older, did not look upon her and immediately say, "Ah, a grizzled comrade like myself." Instead, they presumed that she was somebody's girlfriend, or even daughter, and whilst trying to strike up conversation with her, you know, trying to be nice to the person who come to watch, they'd be like, "Oh, are you here to check on your dad?" or stuff like that. It's an old man who's trying to be nice, trying to include the person in the game. And of course, she was horrified by this. How could you? She has to explain herself in every interaction. How dreadful. It's not like you're an outlier here or anything after all. You're surrounded by your own words, nothing but men, white men, above the age of 50, and you as the single woman is presumed to be an outsider. How mysterious. But of course, we can't simply just let this go. We can't simply let this example of old men trying to be nice go unpunished. This is a crime, don't you understand? This is a problem that the company has to deal with, apparently. First and foremost, talk about non-problem. Even more so since they couldn't even find an example of this in Warhammer. They had to go to a niche within a niche to find something, anything to complain about. Moreover, why does the company have to do anything about this? Why is this a big enough issue for the company to intervene? Well, that's when the next point always comes in. It's usually the argument that, oh, but you see, there are so many women playing the games now, the companies have to cater to them, you see. Now, usually you'll have to look up the stats for yourself and actually go, no, that's not actually the case. But in this case, the article itself does it for you and states that the total number of women within the hobby, in the case of the Great Wargaming Survey here, is between 1.5 to 2%. So this complete and utter non-problem affects at most 2% of people. This right here is not grievance mining. It's not grievance archaeology. This is grievance strip mining on an industrial level. They are discovering 0.0002 grams of grievance per cubic ton extracted from this mine. And yet, just like the finest diamond, it is enough to the crazies. And this is also where you should utterly dismiss the entire argument and the entire article right then and there. Because the doting old man did nothing wrong. He had a 98% chance in being correct in his assumption that this girl watching the game right here has no idea what's going on, and so he's trying to be kind by including her in the game. He is, you might even say, trying to be inclusive. And of course, throughout it, it is always framed as if this is somehow a problem, which is another thing that you need to reject. When they're saying that the hobby hasn't caught up to the modern day, you simply need to say, no, it has caught up to the modern day. It is, as the article mentions, currently experiencing an unrivaled, unprecedented boom. This is simply just the demographic which it appeals to. And anything that appeals to everyone is, at the end of the day, nothing. It is bland and boring paste and should be rejected as such. And that is, of course, the immediate next point. As I keep saying, the demand for change. Though they do make a good point that the prices of wargaming is way, way, way too high, they immediately move on to whinging about the rules. Oh, you've got 2 to 3 pages of rules per unit, says a clueless outsider. All right, if you can't handle it, pick another bloody war game. There are plenty of them. Warhammer 40K can be played so easily right now, it's not even funny compared to previous iterations. And then as well, I love this quote. Quote, "You have to trust in your opponent's honesty and sportsmanship to graciously explain the rules without patronizing you," says the same entitled Lazy Outsider. I'm sorry, but if you're coming into this hobby and you're like, oh, there's too many rules to learn, and then you ask your opponent, could you help me? Could you help me, please? Then he probably is going to do so, but do expect to be patronized because you are lesser. Simply just the fact of it. You don't know the rules. You are playing a game against someone who does know and doesn't want to have their time wasted by you. A little bit of is the least you can bloody swallow for that, because he has no responsibility to teach you how to play the goddamn game. Now, in a friendly environment with people you know, maybe you can have different expectations, but this is presented as just some random opponent. You are taking away his time and his enjoyment of the game for your sake, and then you have the balls to demand he use a certain tone on top of that? Entitlement is the problem with today's society, I tell ya. From one old man to another. It also, of course, whines about highly competitive power gamers and that there's an internal meta. Again, if you're playing with random people, particularly in the hobby shop scenario, you do expect tryhards. In a competitive hobby like wargaming, there are going to be people who are competitive. If you don't want that, say so. Okay, like, I don't want a power hardy game. I want something a little bit more thematic, right? I do that all the time when I play Tabletop Simulator 40K. I usually just come up with a random ass ridiculous theme and just build my army entirely around that. I've been currently playing a lot of a game called Steel Division 2. I prefer playing stupid decks, like the Romanians or the Finnish in World War II. And believe you me, they're not great, but they do have a lot of character to them. Hearing a random Finnish dude start singing some obscure, nonsensical, I swear to God, made-up Finnish language songity-do whilst tossing Molotov cocktails at advancing Russian tanks is quite the experience. And of course, the solution to all of this? Simplify the rules. Dumb it down for us. Make it easier. And also, of course, discourage competitiveness. We don't want that. You shouldn't play the game the way you want. You should play it the way I want. Now, of course, I know I could tell you that I would like this kind of game, but it'd be much easier if the entire company could just cater to my demands, frankly. No. Go away, screw yourselves. This is the hobby as it is right here. If you don't like it, you are free to leave, but don't whinge about what other people enjoy because you have a problem with it. And to fully illustrate this point, she goes on to say that the demographic who play board games tend to be millennials or Gen Xers, whilst the people who play war games tend to be the boomery types. Okay, you are comparing oil to goddamn water. Board games and war games, despite their apparent immediate superficial similarities, could probably not be further apart, particularly in terms of competitiveness. And the best part too is, she has a daughter who is 12 and apparently played a Warhammer tournament when she was about 9. Now that is a hobbyist right there. A 9-year-old girl who goes to a tournament. That is a gamer. And of course it goes on to say, oh, maybe she wouldn't have been interested if I had protected her and coddled her, but you know what? nonsense. If you're interested in wargaming, you're interested in wargaming. I don't think that has anything to do with how you were accepted into it, and certainly not whether or not you were given a little bit of sass whilst asking for the rules to be read to you again. If you love it, you love it. Simple as. Then, at the tail end comes the gist, the punch, the ask. In this case, it's racism and sexism, demanding women's only, and specific race only, gaming nights. Because we can't have those filthy, dirty, disgusting, morally degenerate, malignant, parasitic-like white people intrude upon our sacred spaces. I swear to God, 50 years from now, historians will look back at shit like this, like we do to the Germans today, and wonder, but how could they not have seen it coming? Because humanity has the memory of a goddamn goldfish. That's why. Now, the idea of beginners-only nights? Certainly, absolutely, do it, that's smart. But beginners-only nights for blacks? For women? No. In fact, I'm even pretty sure it is illegal. But, as we always say, it's okay when we do it. And the best part? The absolute little raisin in the sausage right there, the piece de resistance, is the justification. Why do we need a white rise at the back of the bus sign hung up in our hobby stores? Well, it's to reduce the exposure to gatekeeping. The sheer, undiluted brass balls to sit there and write, why do we need to keep the evil white people out of our spaces? Oh, it's to reduce gatekeeping. Good God. The mental gymnastics required. This is why I am firmly becoming of the opinion that this has nothing to do with mental gymnastics. This is not an accident. This is malicious intent. You know what they say, once, that's happenstance. Twice, that's a coincidence. Three times, that's enemy action right there, bro. And of course, the wrap-up takes it one step further. Because it's not enough for private initiatives to do this, for individual clubs, individual organizations, in which case I might just throw up my hands and go like, okay, you go be racist over there. No. Quote, so let's hope that those firms get to work and slowly but surely bring wargaming up to speed with the rest of the beautiful, inventive, collaborative tabletop universe. By slamming the door shut in the face of those with the incorrect skin color or genitalia. Because it always has to do with power. It always has to do with influence. They want into your hobby, and they want to shut the door on you. And you need to point out this blatant hypocrisy whenever you see it. It's really simple. It's very easy because, good God, most of these articles, hell, all of them, are terribly written. They are self-defeating, use circular logic, and are near universally based on the thinnest sliver of grievance you could possibly imagine. This one? Particularly bad. At least in most cases, they simply just claim that there's a problem instead of defeating their own point by giving you the awful example in full glorious detail. And with all that having been said, I have but one more thing to mention, namely, go forth, my brave brethren. Go forth and gatekeep like you've never gatekept before, because they sure as hell are going to. And they're not going to gatekeep merely based upon whether or not you actually like the hobby. They are going to keep you out based on your skin color and your genitals. Until next time, I have been Arch. Thank you all very much for watching. And I hope to see you all again soon. Have a good day.